week.
You mean to tell me that's not you?
No, it's not.
Would you say that was a fair likeness?
Did you say that baby's up there?
Yeah.
Your parents know where you are.
Where did you go from Seattle?
You can call in town.
Well, you have parents, or are they dead?
Where are your parents?
New Mexico.
In New Mexico?
Do you have a phone we can call in?
No, I don't think so.
They don't have a phone?
I don't know if they have a phone number.
You don't know what the number is?
No.
What does your father do for a living? What kind of work does your father do?
Businessman.
Businessman? He doesn't have a phone?
Don't evade the questions, honey.
How can he do business without a phone?
I don't know the phone. I don't have
you
any
don't
contact
know the phone.
With my parents.
How long has it been?
Now, your parents are concerned about you?
I don't think they are.
Oh, I see. What kind of business does your father do?
What does that mean?
Well, it might help us to get in touch with him is what we'll have to do. You see, they'll have to hold you at the Youth Guidance Center until we can contact your parents.
All you have to do is call in town.
No, that doesn't... verify anything. It doesn't verify your age. It
you
verifies the age
lawyer.
That you told him you were the first time you were arrested.
You can call my lawyer.
Well, we not even give us the right to just check to see if you are 18?
I feel embarrassed. I'm always being pulled in all the time.
How many times have you been pulled in?
Parents.
How many times
Twice.
Have you... It's embarrassing for your parents because you got pulled in for possession of marijuana? I should hope so.
It wasn't my marijuana. It was my house.
Oh, you just happened to be in the house. Oh, you weren't aware. Okay.
Why do you object to me phoning your parents and establishing whether you're 18? You don't trust me?
No, I don't.
Well, I'll let you listen while I talk to them. And you can talk to them also.
I don't know the number.
Well, you just said that your attorney called them.
Well, he has the number. I don't.
Well, how did he get the number?
I don't know.
You don't know?
Suppose he looked it up.
He what?
He probably looked it up.
Well, how could he look it up without you supplying your home address?
What city do they live in?
Alameda, New Mexico.
Alameda, New Mexico. And what's the street number?
I don't know.
You don't remember?
I don't remember.
You just refused to tell us?
I don't remember.
You right? told your attorney your address, didn't you? Isn't that true?
Yes, it is.
Well, why can't you remember?
Because I don't want to.
You don't want to remember?
I don't want to tell
why
you.
Would
oh, you don't
not,
want to tell me?
Why would you not want to be cooperative
I
with us?
I didn't know it offhand. I'll put it that way.
Why don't you want to cooperate with
a couple of days and did I rouse you?
No, I don't know.
When you picture, you don't dig the samples.
Uh-huh. You seem to dig people who have marijuana in their homes. We certainly wouldn't do anything to put you in that serious a predicament.
I was staying in a...
Yes, I understand.
In a place and there was marijuana and it was busted.
Yeah, I understand. Well, I'd be more suspicious...
Until I contact your parents. You came directly here. A month ago.
No.
We don't want to arrest you. We have to establish who you are and what your age is.
I told you, call my lawyer.
Call your lawyer.
And what's his phone number?
Who is he?
It's Sidney Tanner. You can look him up.
I guess that's where we're going to have to start.
What's his name?
Sidney.
Glittering silver. Of solitude in the darkest risk of blue purple, just the enchantment of fulfilling your wish, the wish you made to be there, just sitting on a star. Just five, but the circle of points extending transversely from their core, giving the glisten to your hair and eyes that show your anguish to be there. Just with clothes of faith no end, and you think who you are. Sunny nights can be all that they seem. When you get there, you'll know what I mean. When you've reached it, you can find peace and truth. Two things so hard to find. On a throne, now that you're there, just sitting on a star with clothes of lace velvet, and you think where you are.
Upper middle class, and the kids are pretty rich, and the school is pretty social. I don't think I was too happy there because I didn't feel I was getting anything out of it. I wasn't learning anything. I wasn't learning anything important. I was just, it was like I was being babysat every day. I mean, and the kids there are really, really cruel. And like, if you're in a real social group or a clique, and you start going around with sort of rejects, the people that they've rejected out of their little classes, then they'll just put you down left and right. I didn't like it at all.
Just wait for a second about life in the Haight-Ashbury. What did you do all day while you were up there?
Well, first I want to tell you that when I first got there, I mean, I was never shown so much kindness by so many people in my life. I don't know if it's just San Francisco or if it's just Haight-Ashbury, but I couldn't believe it. Everyone's just willing to just go out of their way for you and do everything they could to help you. It was really nice. Let's see, when I was staying with these girls, I didn't have much to do because they both went to school and one of them worked. But I was a little bit frightened at first to walk around the streets because I was paranoid about the police. I wouldn't look any of them in the eye. I was sure they were all looking for me, naturally. They were all just looking for me. And it was during September, I guess, and the last 2 weeks in September, and there was school on, so I thought, oh boy, I'm not in school from 8 to 3. They're going to pick me up for sure. But I just walked around Haight-Ashbury, and then I'd take the bus downtown sometimes. And then I had a friend there that was going to school, and so I went to school with him 2 or 3 days. And got to know a teacher of his, and it was really kind of fun. I liked their school a lot, and comparison to our school was fantastic. And then...
Why was that school better? Haight-Ashbury for a minute. Some of the young people that have gone up there have complained about uncomfortable living, bad food, and nowhere to sleep and that kind of thing. Did you run into any of that?
No, not really. I guess I was pretty lucky. I only came across that once, and I didn't stay there. I really couldn't take it because I didn't like it, but what was it like? Well, this person... It was like he lived in a closet, and all he had was, didn't have any furniture, and all there was just garbage on the floor, and, you know, pretty sickening. But, I mean, he was nice and everything, but I just didn't like it there, and so I left. That was the night that I didn't have any place to go, and I just ended up wandering around the streets, and it was about 10:30 or 11, and that was a really scary night. I didn't really dig that too much. But eventually I did find a place to stay. It was all right.
Running away. Would you tell us why you ran away from home?
Well, the main reason was I wasn't getting along too well with my parents, especially with my father. I didn't feel that he liked the way I was handling myself generally, the people I was going around with, things I did and the way I talked, just everything about me, the way I look, the clothes I wear. I mean, everything was sort of a hassle. I couldn't really, you know, do anything around here. And I think there was sort of a loss of respect on both sides. He told me right before I left that he didn't, you know, feel very much respect for me anymore, and I didn't feel much for him either.
Talked with her.
Really?
Yeah.
What a coincidence.
Right.
My goodness, this is wonderful.
Great. Doesn't remember.
Running away. It was the best thing I ever did.
Why is that?
God, none of this stuff would have been ever brought out into the open. None of our problems, none of the barriers that we set up between each other, none of the really deep things that's been going on in our family would have ever come out into the open.
Things that we're talking about today.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the good examples of this is we've been talking now for about an hour and a half, and no one's brought up this letter. And I think it's a good example of how you've learned not to communicate somehow. Tim wrote you a letter the other day, and you got it, and you were very moved by it, and you were even, I think, crying when I saw you, and I got to read part of it, and I thought it was a very moving thing that he wrote to you, and neither one of you have talked about it in here for an hour and a half now we've been talking, and none of you have mentioned it, and I just wonder, your father needs a little feedback on the letter to even know how you respond to it, and
yeah.
You haven't given it.
At first, it was really shocking to me. You said things you've never probably told anybody, I think. You never told Mom, you never told me. I mean, like, it was really sad. It was a real tearjerker, and I really...
About his background.
Yeah.
Some of his hang-ups.
About your...
Growing up.
Your childhood and everything. But then, I thought, well... Since we haven't, you know, you haven't brought it up and we haven't talked about any of your sort of hang-ups tonight, I thought maybe that letter was just a way to get me back home. I thought you didn't really mean it. I thought it was just a gimmick. You know, I thought you thought, well, this will really get her. She's got to come back home.
Oh, boy.
So this is exactly what happens. I mean, he wrote the letter and he didn't get any feedback on it, so you couldn't really find out what his motivations were,
right.
Really. And at one point you're moved by it, another point a little angry. And of course he hasn't asked you either what you felt about the letter either. He hasn't risked and dared to ask you what you thought of it. And I think that he may have thought you didn't like what he said and rejected it. And so both of you were kind of afraid to bring it up.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just another good example, I think, of a communication breakdown where our fears, you know, get in the way.
Yes, I didn't know what to make of her silence, and I guess she didn't know what to make of mine either.
Yeah. There's the families then that don't communicate anymore, or they're just sullen and so hurt they can't talk. Then there's another whole category of people who communicate very clearly. And this would be a case where a lot of times it's very ironic that a kid will pick up the values of his parents. Like they say, think for yourself, John. And John starts thinking for himself, and boy, the communication is very clear. John isn't thinking the same way the parents are. And then they get into a big value hassle, usually about how free John is to go places and whether he's ready to make certain decisions or not. And there's a big struggle there. And the son or the daughter is really struggling to grow up. And the parents are trying to protect the son or daughter from making risky decisions. And most of us know that there aren't very many decisions that aren't risky. And so there's that kind of conflict, and sometimes they have to. You find what happens is sometimes a person will. We've had a couple in here who are just kind of touring the USA without their Chevrolet, and they've just left home. They like their parents. They say, but that's all there is for me there, and I have to see the world myself. There are a few like that, and they're very interesting to talk to. So those are kind of the range of runaway problems. letter brought up a little bit about also, I think what's going on is I've watched all of you relate to each other and so on, is that it seems like there's some kind of a scheme going on to protect him, and I wonder why that has come about. Do you have any idea, Rosa?
Well, I think we have had a protective attitude in a sense, both protective of him because we felt he might be hurt by certain things, and also that his reaction might hurt us. It might be too strong a reaction.
Explosive. Mm-hmm. You ever get mad?
Oh, not really. I'm a very placid sort of a guy.
Placid, yeah. Sure. We'll check that out.
Well, I am.
Do you think he's placid?
Not when he's not.
Oh. Very easygoing.
Well, maybe.
Except when we touch on certain subjects you're afraid to talk about. Then it's either you stomping out of the room, getting mad, blowing up, or something.
Oh, I don't. I talk about things.
I don't know.
Anyway, so, yeah, you can be placid to protect yourself. That might be a clever way of not getting into things, just to kind of be just nonplussed about everything. But I think there's a little coalition going on, and...
Well, don't you, Kelly, you've heard yourself say, and the other girls say, well, if don't tell Daddy something.
Right, yeah. It seems like I know I talk to you more about more things. I don't know what it is, but it just seems like I talk to you more than I talk to him. Well, one reason is because he hasn't hardly been home very much because of his business, right. But... Yeah, right. I can remember myself saying that because we just didn't want to bring it up and hurt him anymore, I guess.
Okay, but what's happened is that, okay, in protecting Tim, something else happens. And Tim, I mean, do you need to be protected, Tim? I mean,
no, of course not.
What happens, I think, to Tim in the process is that in being protected, he also gets excluded. And he's sitting out there in right field wondering what's going on in the family. Now, this has been a two-way process, I think, all along, because as I understand it, the other two daughters, the older ones, also, and you complain about not hardly knowing Tim, not knowing him. And it's been something that you've all worked out with Tim somehow in the past years where Tim doesn't get into more the deeper material. I don't mean, well, whatever it is that moves him and moves you, you kind of shy away from it.
Yeah, anything, just like religion or politics, anything that really matters. All we talked about was little trivial things.
So this is your complaint about the relationship. But you see, everybody's participating in it because you two, Rosalie and you, keep on protecting him, and I don't think he wants to be protected anymore. I think you want to be included.
I certainly do. It's so many times I've felt I've had the role of a policeman, you know, and then really not over just these trivialities, mm-hmm. truly.
And in our society, we keep policemen outside,
mm-hmm.
really.
Mm-hmm. You only call them when you need them, you know. It's never really part of the community or the whatever.
Well, I think this is a very important, I call it a game, don't tell Daddy. That what it amounts to is that people get the message from you, Tim, that you're going to break up maybe if you talk about something pretty significant. So they learn to skirt around you, and yet in doing so, it leaves you out, and you really feel out, and really can't have the relationship with Kelly that both of you want. And so that's what this is all about today. That's where I want to go.
Kelly, I'm not sure I really understand why you ran away.
Well, I guess it was a combination of two really important things. One, my situation at school was getting pretty intolerable. I was sort of being rejected by all my old friends, it seemed like. They thought it was some kind of a hippie. I heard rumors about myself, and I knew they were saying things behind my back. I don't know what. Somebody told me that they said I was getting involved with all the drugs and everything just because I was going around with a new set of people. I guess they don't have a very good reputation or something. But they automatically thought that just because I was going around with them, I'd, you know, get involved with all the, you know, drugs and free sex and everything. I was losing my reputation.
And it hurt because of they're jumping to these.
Well, yeah, it. I mean, I don't care about those people anymore, but it just really bothered me that a lot of people, I mean, it seemed like were talking about me.
Your old friends?
Yeah.
Good old friends?
Yeah.
Really? Gee, it's news to me.
And also, I didn't feel like I was getting anywhere with my teachers. I really don't like that school very much because it's like a more like a babysitting service. They talk at you, they don't talk to you. You can't get close to any of the teachers there.
But it wasn't all school, was it?
No, that was only half of it. It was really what was going on at home, too. I felt like I was losing respect. In fact, Daddy told me the night I left that he didn't respect me anymore. Do you remember saying that? You see? So I don't feel...
That was ever enjoyed by any boy. You're not the only choo-choo train that was left out in the rain the day after Santa came. You're not the only charity light that was left in the night and gave up without a fight. You're not the only cuddly toy that was ever enjoyed by any boy. You're not the kind of girl to tell your mother, the kind of company you keep. I never told you that to love no other, you must have dreamed it in your sleep. You're not the only cuddly toy that was ever enjoyed by any boy. You're not the only choo-choo train that was left out in the rain the day after Santa came. You're not the only charity light that was left in the night and gave up without a fight. You're not the only cuddly toy that was ever enjoyed by any boy. You're not the kind.